Chioli?
Yes.
Chioli is a huge village now.
It is big.
So, and
we stayed close to that creek, Bagator River.
Close to the?
Creek.
The creek. Creek.
Bagator River.
Chioli virtually has four or five different hamlets, almost probably villages and panchayats, two, three panchayats.
Yeah, I know, it's quite big.
It's big,
yeah.
It's big. Mario Rodriguez, my old friend.
My house is very close to Alex's place, just 5 minutes walking.
On the main road? Oh gosh, that's your mother's side, this is your father's side?
Yeah. So but I think I visited this place two or three times when I went there.
But hats off to you all, Bomaikars. Maybe because of the distance or whatever, you all have kept your links in that sense. Anyway, today's agenda is Mario Rodriguez, who has been a friend, a kind of a mentor, someone whom I've looked up to, whose journalism I've looked up to for a long, long, long time. Of course, I'm not in sports, everyone knows that. But Mario has been in things other than sports also. Mario, tell us about your journalistic journey.
I entered the profession in 1981 or 82 when the daily started, the paper
Karanja's daily,
floated by Rusi Karanja. Before that, I was doing a little bit freelancing. I was working for the Times in the ad department. Somehow they took me on, and that's how it began. And after that, I joined Blitz also as a sub-editor, reporter. आमच्या भाषेत बी उलोय
होय रे आमच्या भाषेत मी तसे काय ना देर नो प्रॉब्लेम पण इंग्लिशीन सुबेज लोकांक सदमंग सदमंग जातले
ओके सो अँड देन इन ब्लिट्स बिकॉज ऑफ ऑर्गनायझिंग दिस नेहरू सेंटनरी ब्लिट्स सायकल रेस
वी हॅव टू टॉक अबाउट दॅट दॅट्स अ स्टोरी इन इटसेल्फ आय नो इट्स व्हेरी इम्पॉर्टंट वी विल कम टू दॅट
आय वॉज डिरेक्टली प्रमोटेड एज स्पोर्ट्स एडिटर बिकॉज आय वॉज ऑल्सो हँडलिंग द स्पोर्ट्स पेजेस apart from doing regular journalistic work. Then I worked there till 1993, after which I joined The Independent, which as you know...
Which was a great paper run by Vinod Mehta for a little while.
But yeah, but when I was there, Dina Vakil and Bachi Karkaria were the editors.
Vinod was out.
Vinod was out at that time. And then it suddenly folded up and they started Bombay Times. And they told the staff one day they... Management, Mr. Arora, called for a meeting and said, we are closing this down, but we are going to start another paper. And he also made an important point that people think of, say, rights and war, etc. Journalism and deserves front page stuff, but we will also try to branch out into a different sort of journalism, like beauty contests, celebrities, etc., etc. And the page tree, which now is associated with, say, celebrities and other society sort of dues. At that time, page tree in Bombay Times was actually a city issue based page where issues affecting the city were reported on. So I worked
civic issues, civic issues,
civic issues, etc., etc. Yes, and then in 1995 I joined the Statesman, where I lasted for quite some time till 2000 as a Bombay correspondent. Initially they wanted a sports reporter, but since I could dabble in all subjects under the sun, I got the nod. Which I did quite including reporting on politics in Goa. There used to be a...
States
column. So I regularly file reports sitting in Bomai and...
Which in those days was a done thing because the news used to not travel. News used to not travel. Occasionally come
and
down.
And occasionally visiting Goa.
Yeah.
Including for two of the first two film festivals, which I reported on since I also dabbled in cinema writing.
So you were in Statesman till?
Till 2007, after which I resigned, and I was jobless for a few months, and this offer from the Z Group, which wanted to start a sports magazine, because that time they were getting heavily into sports, so it was called All Sports Magazine, and I worked there till 2011,
nice.
Before it was suddenly shut down on the ground that it was a loss-making entity, but I think that was sabotaged by rival factions in the family.
I see.
Because every 6 months or so, it used to be passed on from one of the family members to another.
Okay.
And one fine day it finally shut down in 2011.
If I could ask, at what stage did Bombay stop being the media capital of India? If that is a correct question.
I don't know if it was the media capital of India.
It was, undeniably it was.
Because, of course, the capital of the country is New Delhi, where all the big guns used to sit.
No, but all the big newspapers and magazines and everything came out from Bombay, no?
Yeah, but you had in that respect, okay, from the number of magazines, Bombay did have a sizable output of periodicals, etc., etc. But, I never had the impression.
We'll agree to disagree, but I clearly remember.
I never had the impression that Bombay was
I clearly remember that.
It was the media capital.
I clearly remember it was, because we always reported to Bombay. Okay. And Bombay understood Goa to quite some extent,
okay,
unlike Delhi. And all the big guns were sitting in Bombay in that sense. And then suddenly Times Group shifted, and you know, somewhere in the 90s or 2000s.
Okay,
or
you
God
can
knows
say that. The headquarters of the Indian Express and Times were in Bombay.
And all the magazines were also there, no? Illustrated Weekly and Sports Week.
Sports Week was...
Chennai? Was Sports World?
Sports Star was
Sports Star.
The Hindu group. Sports Week was owned by...
Midday Group. Bombay.
Yeah. Sports World, the Anand Bazar Patrika.
You always wanted to become a journalist from young?
No, I just sort of gate crashed into it, but...
You enjoyed it. You enjoyed the innings.
Yeah, I have no regrets.
If you had a chance, you would do it again?
I don't know. Yeah, probably, because...
it's fun. It was fun.
In journalism, you... I mean, okay, if you're a sport journalist, you're only covering a limited beat, maybe certain sports... But you get to venture into many fields, like in the 1980s, early 1980s, when I was with the Daily. There was this conference of Catholic bishops in Bombay called the CBCI, Catholic
Bishops Conference of India.
I was the only Christian in that
organization,
in the features department.
Yeah.
So the chief of the department said, "See, this is happening here. Why don't you go and cover it?" And I mean, apart from going to church at that time, though I was not religious, I knew nothing about the church. So I went there and I did a story feature, which I think was reporting this whole issues about liberation theology, which was just coming in. A lot of priests agitating for social justice and more liberal approach by the church in respect to various issues.
Right.
I mean, even though the official line against abortion, say, birth control, etc., may have been there, but it was not, I mean, the hierarchy didn't come down very heavily on it. So after that, I started writing regularly on church issues.
I see.
And I mean, I was rather knowledgeable about the subject. And then one of the organizations that that I'd interviewed was a Christian-based activist organization called BILD. You may have heard of
BILD,
it.
BILD, in Bombay.
Yeah, in which two Catholic priests were quite prominent, including Reggie Gomes and Father Raymond De Silva.
Father Raymond.
Yeah.
Father Raymond is around? Or
no, he died about 10, 15 years ago.
I see. We heard a lot about him.
Yeah, he was a great man. So that was funded by the Protestant...
Bread for the World, German organization.
Church groups.
In Germany.
So one day I went there to meet some of the friends, because I knew all of them that well. So this father, Reggie, told me, "See, we've got an invitation from the churches of the Northeast, and there's a delegation of Protestant church members who are going there. We don't have anybody to send. Would you like to go?" So that I jumped at the opportunity of touring the Northeast as a member of the NCC, National Council of Churches for India, though I was not connected to any of them. And then the chief of the Christian Conference of Asia had also come down, youth leader. So he invited me on a trip to China, though I was member of
the Protestant.
Neither of the Catholic Church, because by then I had discontinued all affiliation with any religion.
Yeah.
So
it opens doors. Journalism does open doors. It allows us to meet people too, you know. Tell us about your books, Mario.
You mean the Ranji book?
More than one you've done, no?
No, I only that's one. The only book that was published in 2003. It also happened by accident, like...
life happens by accident.
Yeah, I... instead of doing regular sports reporting, I always looked for other angles, especially some anti-establishment.
Critical, going against the tide, something that is...
something that...
Not known in history.
Yeah, infuriate others or whatever. So then I stumbled on this whole relationship between cricket and imperialism, and also Indian cricket and
the empire,
and British imperialism, and also the role of the princes in the promotion of cricket. Then I found out about Ranjit Singh. There were many books written on him, but all were
laudatory
hagiographies.
Hagiographies.
Started researching a lot, especially in the archives, state archives.
Where? Bombay?
Bombay, New Delhi. But the problem with this archives in India is there are many files which are restricted.
I see.
Yeah. But if you go to the British Library, almost 95% of them are accessible to everybody.
Yeah.
So that's how the book came about. And I put together that.
So it's as much of politics as it is about sports.
It's not about sports because cricket just gets.
I don't put the sugar. If you want the sugar, they have it.
Okay, no issue.
Thanks.
So about his cricket, there's just one or two chapters. See. The rest is about his politics.
I see.
But that's history now. I mean, you don't live on your past.
No, but it must have been very tough to put it together, no? Considering the amount of work involved.
No, I think the tougher part of the book, especially for new writers, is finding a publisher. And I must thank Ramchandra Guha for putting in a word at Penguin.
I see.
And also giving them a little nudge.
Okay.
And let it happen.
Would you recommend that journalists write their books at some stage?
Only if that journalist has been a central part of history, then he could probably...
Not their biography, autobiography. Okay. I'm talking about writing a book.
Anybody can write a book. Why not journalists? If you have something important to say, and if you can say it in a manner that is interesting...
Everybody. It's very different, no, to put together a book in that sense.
Yeah, like I said, the more difficult part... For me, was not writing it, but finding a publisher.
You're a voracious reader, obviously.
Not really.
Not now.
Basically, I only read non-fiction.
That's true with a lot of us. Like, we can read anything in non-fiction. I always joke and say I could read a magical textbook, but I can't read fiction. Yeah. Difficult to read fiction.
It's not difficult, but...
Not enjoyable.
So attuned now to... But I think it's important to take a break once in a while for your reading habits, because... I don't think non-fiction has any literary quality, though there are some very good writers of non-fiction. So to get some sort of flair and expand your imagery and mental and thinking.
Mario, in the Blitz or Daily, you rose to become associate editor. What was that? What was the highest post you held there?
No, like I told you, I was a sub-editor come reporter in both these organization, but after handling the cycle race, Karanja immediately promoted me.
Karanja,
Rusi Karanja, he's the post of a sports editor with a little raise and salary, but just a designation because I never handle any department except for myself.
How was working with Karanja like?
It's one of the best experiences that I had in my journalism career. I mean, people say a lot of things
negative as well as
positive, but yeah. All those who worked in the Daily and Blitz will not forget him, because he may have been taking money from the Soviets or the Congress, and as you know, in the later part of his life, he
BJP went to BJP,
BJP under the influence of Sudhindra Kulkarni.
I see. Under influence of Sudhindra Kulkarni, yeah, who was his former journalist,
who was with us in the Daily. Huh. Then he had left, and Sainath was the deputy editor of the Blitz, so I worked under Sainath as well. And then, although these things were said about him, he was a great guy to work with. Temperamental Parsi, if I may say that, he threw his tantrums and all, but he forgot it the very next minute.
Really?
Yeah, and he also rewarded people instantly. He was a good-hearted man. Many guys have conned him for money and all that, so because anybody came with a soft story, he gave you something.
Where was your office?
It was at Kavasti Patel Street and Fort.
I remember the address. Interesting. Counter media. I remember it as if it was yesterday. Must be about 35 years back, maybe more.
When we were in the Blitz in the late 1980s.
And to interrupt while you're talking, it was a magazine critiquing the media, put together on an electronic typewriter, done very aesthetically. And it made a whole lot of points, because in those days the idea of critiquing the media wasn't still on the scene. Tell us about it.
The right person to ask this question was Sainath, though my name was there on the editorial board.
Okay.
It was, and along with Jesse Kochar, an ex-Indian Navy chap, and Vivek Montero, the trade
unionist.
Yes.
Brigadier Montero's son.
I don't know about who his father was.
In Goa.
So, I was just there on the... my name was just there on the editorial board, and I did help a little bit. But I think it was ahead of its time in India.
Yeah.
Because we did some really great stories, and I remember a piece by Vivek Montero reviewing a book on JRD. Where JRD said his only association with the freedom struggle was he once watched a demonstration or a morcha from afar, but he didn't take any part in it.
I see. Yeah, it was quite a radical and well brought out magazine. That was
the quality of writing also was pretty good.
So that was a sign of P. Sainath, who was yet to emerge, no? Because P. Sainath was
I think he was already a name in the field of journalism even at that time.
In editing or writing?
In both.
Both?
Yeah. I've worked under him for about 6 or 7 years. I can say he's the most wonderful human being. Yeah.
Really?
Absolutely a gem for character.
Really?
And he's an expert on various subjects. Like
he knows like in the back of his hand, he knows it. Very well.
Now, as you know, that he's an expert on farming and farmer suicide, etc., etc. He's been in the news for that reason. But even on media, he's an expert.
Yeah.
And foreign affairs, imperialism. Like once I remember, I did a story on the Vietnam movies.
I see.
So I asked him for a reference. So he said, refer to Newsweek, issue dated so and
really?
Page number so and so.
Oh gosh.
So he's got that sort of phenomenal idea. And one more point I might add. He's a very good singer and guitarist, and he can rattle off 50 Paul Simon songs off the trot.
Really? No one knew this?
No, people in the circles certainly knew about it.
How have you seen journalism changing?
We've seen the formal introduction of paid news now, in the last 10, 20 years or even before. It was revolutionized or introduced by the Times Group, but offhand there was always deals going on behind
the scenes. It was not formal, that's all.
It was not formal, where people took money, favors, etc., etc. Sometimes the paid news or the proceeds of the paid news didn't go to the organization.
Yeah,
the journalists may have made
a
private deal and planted stories, this and that. So this is an insidious part of it. Anyway, it's good that things are brought out in the open, but as long as there is a disclaimer put that this is a paid story or whatever, I mean, you can't argue much with that. At least people will know that they are not being taken for a ride.
Would you think the Indian journalist did better stories when he had lower salaries and more fire in his belly, he or she? Would it be fair to say that?
At that time, with most journalists, especially in the reporting and all, there was an eagerness to get stories and do some anti-establishment stories and even offbeat stories, etc. I cannot comment on what the scene is now since I've been out of working journalism since 2011, except when I had a spell as the editor of the Indian Football League website in the first season, 2014.
Anurabha Chaudhary, who's that? Who ran it? Anurabha
Chaudhary? No, that was IndianFootball.com. That was the website of that. I'm talking the Indian Super League.
Okay, okay.
The official website.
Okay, the official website.
I was associated with that in the first season. So I don't know what journalism is doing now, but as you know, there are several media organizations which have totally sold out to this ruling party at the center. And there were papers which supported various political formations.
Like in the past also.
In the past. Like I said, Blitz was accused of favoring the Congress for quite some time, which
is most true.
Likely, yes, to be true. And but now you can see that major sections of...
The biggest papers and the most influential ones.
Yeah, have just simply bowed down and fallen over, and they are not even doing journalism, they are doing dirty, vicious, communal, neoliberal, you can use all sorts of expletives. They are doing propaganda, like look at this guy, Sudhir Chaudhary, you must have heard of him doing stories of jihad, etc., etc. And you know, the Godi media, there are so many names who are prominent in that.
Yeah. And they don't even need to because they're quite big players actually. They're not struggling.
What journalism is that? It's not journalism, it's just propaganda.
The Goan journalist and sports, what's the connection?
I have no connection with Goan journalism except...
the accidental writing, fact that you're Goan.
For writing on Goa often. And I also wrote for Goa Today quite some time under when Manohar
Shetty
was there, and later when Naik also took over. Yeah, I did quite a few cover stories for them also, one including on Kishori Amonkar.
I see.
Varsha Usgaonkar.
Cover stories.
Cover stories.
When they were maybe the person of the year, the woman of the year or...
Yeah, I can't remember, but they were cover stories.
Talking about which, I really loved your piece in Mario Cabrali Sa's book, Winds of Fire.
What about it?
It gave a very synoptic view of the Goan musician in Bombay. You know, I don't think that there is, at least I'm not aware of any other place where so much information is packed into so few pages. Did it take you a long time to create that?
Not really. As you know, Mario Cabral was the producer of the book rather than the author, because there were five or six different...
There are many, about 10 contributors, I think.
Contributors writing on different aspects of Goan music or Goans in music.
Yeah.
And he also was a Goa correspondent for Blitz, as well as the Daily.
As well as the Daily.
Yeah, so we got along well. Once when I had visited Goa and I met him near the secretariat, he dragged me into Monte Cruz's cabin.
I see.
At that time, he was building the stadium for the Nehru Cup. And he...
Patoda Stadium.
And he asked me to... he said that he's all yours for an interview.
I see.
Coming back to the book, since my father was a musician... Lawrence Rodericks, who played in various bands.
For the films, for Bollywood?
Not for Bollywood, and bands.
Okay.
And then he stopped in the 1960s.
Wow.
So I don't remember him playing, but he did. And he was also a member of the Bombay Musicians Association. So they used to have annual socials like...
I see.
Where a lot of bands used to play, three bands. So I attended many of those.
Really?
And I got to hear quite a lot of music. And since I was also interested in music and dabbling a little bit in it, though I was never a professional musician, I knew most of the musicians and the bands. So it was not very difficult putting all these...
But putting it together was very important, because that all those names would have been otherwise lost, probably. I don't think, I've not seen them, you know, collated in that way.
Maybe not, but it sort of happened.
No, in Goa definitely. See, I'll tell you, in Goa the principle is this. If you don't do it, no one else will. If I don't interview, I'm not making myself more important than anyone else. But if I don't interview Mario Rodriguez, probably his story is going to go in that sense. Anyway, your point about the cycle race. I know it means a lot to you. Tell us.
That also happened.
By accident.
Just by chance. As you know, or you may not know, Rossi Karanja was a... sponsor of cycling in the old days.
Really?
And in Bombay, cycling is dominated or has a had a substantial
by the passes.
Contribution and participation by the passes.
Okay.
So absolutely right. And at that time there were two cycling associations. One was the Indian Cycling Association, which was the main association, but in order to encourage professional cycling and bring prize money into the sport, they had floated another organization called the Indian Professional Cycling Association.
I see.
That was dominated by Parsis. So one of those guys came and I used to report on the event. So one day this guy came and put a proposal to Karanja, calling for an All India State Cycle Race. So since I was handling the sports pages, the proposal was passed on to me. It was not my job to look into this proposal.
So you had to organize this Grand Prix?
It came about in stages, because he said, why don't you look into it? So this guy came, we had a recce of the entire route many
times. Which
year? This was in 1989 on the occasion of the Nehru centenary celebration. So then we got the state governments along the route to sponsor the hospitality when the race was passing through their states.
I see.
Including Maharashtra, where the race was flagged off from Bandstand in Bandra, Gujarat, Rajasthan, and directly it passed through
Delhi.
Haryana, a bit of Haryana, and Delhi. So
how many days?
It was I think a 13 days, 10 stage event.
2,000 kilometers or what?
It was about 1,005 kilometers, and there were four international teams there. And the race almost didn't take place. At the last minute, we didn't have a title sponsor. We just a week before the scheduled start of the race.
Yeah.
Then Jaipur representative and representative Vishnu Pancharya, that was his name. He said, "I'll get you the sponsorship if you give me a 10% or whatever advertising commission." Fair enough.
Right.
He's in the business, and he brought a Zandu Bam as the title sponsor.
My goodness!
Almost at the last minute, so the race was on, as it may have never taken place.
I see. Interesting.
And they contributed a sum of about 9 lakhs which was
a lot of money in those days.
Yeah, and the prize, first prize for the was 1 lakh rupees.
Wow.
Plus stage prizes, etc., etc. So that was quite substantial in terms of prize sponsorship amount.
Mario, the role of Goans in journalism, any comment on that? Going down, declining nationally?
I don't think it's in my competence to comment on that, but we had some great Goan journalists and editors who all are aware of. And some very good writers as well. Like, I think Mario Cabral was a fantastic writer. I mean, he could write on anything and be fun. And he used to send almost weekly a report from Goa. And even if there was no story, it was so well written that you didn't feel bad to publish it.
I see.
So there were some very good writers. And so I don't know if the role or the importance of Goans in journalism is going in national journalism.
Yeah.
I mean, here they may be kings of the or queens of the catwalk, but
internationally they seem to be doing something internationally. Yeah. But nationally, you're finding less and less.
I don't
them.
Think of any Goan journalist who's an All India figure now, or even though he's not based in Goan originally.
Yeah.
I mean, you can correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, true. At the pan India level. Playing a role there. Whereas in the past they were, you had Frank Moraes, you had Dom Moraes, you had, of course, Daryl is an East Indian, but still, you had a lot more of...
Mulgaonkar also was
editor
of Indian Express for some time, was he?
Something like that. Then you had Armand D'Souza, who played a role in Ceylon in the 1950s and all those kind of things. You had a whole lot of, this Pio Gama Pinto, who built a press with Nehru money or Soviet money, we don't know, in East Africa and all these kind of... there were quite a few major players. Yeah.
I mean, there certainly were, but I don't know your question. I mean, it remains unanswered because I cannot say what the situation is at the present, nor can I predict the future.
We'll leave that to take as something to think about, but anything else that I should have asked you you'd like to mention?
Yeah, the state of Goan politics.
That's a never-ending topic.
That's a never-ending topic, and the reverence accorded to a great chief minister who recently passed away, which I think that man, without taking his name, but it's very obvious who I'm referring to, had many great qualities, but his drawbacks were not so much publicized as the adulation heaped upon him. One, I think he did not do anything to discourage this phenomenon of Ayaram Gayaram politics, which, as you all know, how he first came to power. Secondly, there's also a question of honor among thieves. When you plot a robbery or a murder or anything, you don't stab the guy who was associated with that, or you don't betray him after that happened. You know what I'm talking about. And then if you remember, in his last days, he refused to demit office. He just kept on clinging to the post, which created a sort of power vacuum in Goa. Of course, they solved it by putting their man there. And his two or three last acts also were a continuation of his dubious legacy. You remember two Congress MLAs defected to the BJP. And one of them, it seems, the government bought over his land, according to a report, for 10 or 20 crores when it was not required. And the last final act was clearing an ecotourism project for his son. And he gave the speech that if I cannot do something for my own kind, who am I supposed to do it for?
Right. The relationship between the diaspora and Goa, how do you see it, particularly the Bombay diaspora?
I think it's declining because so many people have migrated abroad.
True.
That
many have migrated here also, no? Some.
Some have migrated here, and Goa is also becoming popular as a resident destination for non-Goans.
Yeah.
The number of non-Goans who have properties here, is, including Indians, I mean, and some foreigners who have Benami holdings, is quite large.
Thanks for your time, Mario. Real pleasure.
You're
welcome,
Deepo.
This is a noisy setting in Kalangut. Mario brought me to this place. Nice. What's it called?
Capricorn Restaurant.
Capricorn. Thanks.